You are watching DHTV, the broadcast programming service of California State University, Dominguez Hills.
Good afternoon, young scholars. I'm Dr. Robert Cubijos. This is Philosophy 120, Critical Reasoning. And we're coming to you from the California State University Dominguez Hills campus in the DHTV studios. Hope everybody had a great holiday last Wednesday. And yes, we missed the broadcast time. That means that we're going to have to make up for a little bit of that lost time. And we'll do that by increasing our speed a little bit and probably not watching as many videos as we would like to, I'm sure that we can make up for it without too much of a problem. We just finished chapter 4, and there are some things that I emailed you. You need to check your inbox, reminding you that the chapter 4.7 translation work, which is critical reasoning response number 2, ought to be completed. As well, the homework for points for chapter 4, the quiz for chapter 4, and then finally the midterm exam. We extended the deadlines on some of these because of the holiday time and because it was beneficial to you students. So if you've not completed any of those, I would encourage you to do that as soon as possible. Now that we're moving into chapter 5, today we'll probably cover 5.1 and 5.2, but you need to be able to recognize on sight the four categorical propositions, the A, E, I, and O. That's page 204. And you should be able to recognize those immediately. And if you have to go back to 204 to check them out, that's fine. But please, please work on recognizing them on sight, which is the A, the E, the I, and the O. Also, you should be able to recognize how to interpret a Venn diagram. Does this Venn diagram of these two overlapping circles represent an A, E, I, or an O type proposition? That will greatly enhance your ability to move forward in chapter 5. So there's my encouragement to you. A couple of other brief announcements. Because of the holidays and the passing of my father, I was not able to correct all of or post the grade for all of the assignments, but we should be caught up by this weekend. So thank you for those of you that have emailed me asking, where's my grade for this project? As I mentioned, those should be done by this weekend. We're going to jump into our video for our first participation point of the day in just a moment. We want to have open and available chapter 5.1 in your textbook, and we'll be jumping into that in just a few moments, and then we might even get into some of section 5.2. We'll also be doing a few problems on our smart board and watching some videos and debunk them on the smart board. So there are some issues related to maintaining your job that have to do with ethics. And there are some ways to immediately get fired if you have a breach of ethics, if you do some things that should not be done in your company. So our question relates to what you might add to the list. What other breaches of ethics might an employee commit that would result in his or her termination? So make sure that you understand and that you've got something that was not already covered in the video, and then you can email in or call in, and we'll chat briefly or we'll read the first 5 responses on the phone. So let's go on ahead and look at our video, How to Get Fired, Ethical Issues in Business. Watch this.
Yeah. carding?
All right, I'll see what I can do.
All right. Hey boss, I just want to let you know I might be a little late getting back from my lunch break because I need to pick up my daughter from school. Is that alright?
Yes, just please let me know when you get back in.
Alright, will do.
Late.
I'll make a note.
I'll just change that to 9 o'clock. And perfect.
This will come in handy. Huh, would you look at that? Okay, boss, you have a great night.
Oh, thanks, you too, Jeremy.
Thank you.
Suckers.
Okay, now I just need your credit card information. Okay, thank you. I can make that work.
Hey, Kelsey, can you give me those reports by the end of the day?
Yeah, absolutely.
Cool, thank you.
Check this out.
Nice!
Jackpot!
You're fired, you're fired, and you're fired! You're definitely fired!
Okay.
Oh, and I called the cops on you guys. Have a good night!
All right. Well, can you add anything to that? Any other things that you could think of that would probably get you terminated from your job? Email in or call in with those responses, and we'd be happy to award you some participation points. There at the bottom third, you see our phone number and our email address. So take advantage of those to connect with us. Well, we're dealing in chapter 5, and we're speeding up a little bit, folks, with categorical syllogisms. We talked a little bit about categorical syllogisms at the beginning of the term, gave you a few examples, but we do want to reignite our thoughts about categorical syllogisms. Let me give you a few definitions here. Syllogism first is a deductive argument with two premises and one conclusion. That's the definition of a syllogism. Well, how about a categorical syllogism? Well, the first definition is an argument with exactly two premises, where exactly three terms are used exactly twice in exactly two propositions. Don't like that one. Let's go to the second definition that we will use. This is the one from our book, and so you'll be familiar with this. Our book uses the definition of a deductive argument consisting of three categorical propositions that can be translated into standard form. Well, that pretty much hits the nail on the head, but I really prefer this next translation, the one that we'll use in our lectures. And this is the third definition of a categorical syllogism. It consists of three categorical propositions that contain a total of three different terms, each of which appears twice in distinct propositions. So hang on to that idea, and we'll unpack that and show you in a few slides what exactly we're talking about. And matter of fact, this next slide will demonstrate using the three terms soldiers, patriots, and traitors, how they appear twice. So if you take a look at the screen, you'll see that this categorical syllogism has got the three categorical propositions. Notice how patriots in yellow is right over here are two of the terms where they appear. Traitors is down here in the conclusion. It's also here in the second premise. And soldiers, this third term, appears up in this first premise and also down in the conclusion. So here's our definition, categorical syllogism number three. You probably want to become familiar with this because this is the definition that we're going to be using for these categorical type syllogisms. Well, we want to be familiar with the major term. And major term is always the last term in the conclusion. On our next slide, for example, you'll see where it says all soldiers are patriots, no traitors are patriots, thus no traitors are soldiers, that the major term is soldiers. So whenever you're looking at a categorical syllogism, I want your eye to immediately go to the conclusion, the predicate of the conclusion. That is the major term. The major term. Premise of the conclusion is called the major term. Well, what about the minor term? Let's push on here. And let's see if I can erase my... Well, I think as our producer had mentioned, it's going to be giving me problems. Oh, there, we just got it. Before we get to minor term, it looks like we have some folks that are already sending us their responses. Here's from Bailey. Bailey, thank you so much. And trust you're doing well, Bailey. Definite way to get fired in the workplace for unethical behaviors to make unwanted advances or inappropriate comments to another coworker, otherwise known as sexual harassment. I would definitely fire one of my employees if they were guilty of such a charge. Matter of fact, the California Chamber of Commerce now in some of the labor laws in California require managers of certain companies of a certain size to have biannual training on this and to be certified that they have been taught and they've learned about sexual harassment in the workplace. Bailey, really good. Thank you for that. Here's Asher. Another offense that would get a person fired include harassment and public indecency. Yeah, especially around the office, right? An example of public indecency would be running through the office without a shirt yelling, "I'm a hairy monkey." Asher, thank you so much. And appreciate that visual here on an otherwise dry and dreary Wednesday. Asher, thank you for that. We appreciate you injecting some humor into our proceedings here. Well, let's get over to the minor term. The minor term is the subject of the conclusion. Minor term in the categorical syllogism we're looking at is traitors. Its location is here. It is the subject of the conclusion. So as we say here, subject of the conclusion is called the minor term. So by now you should know the major term and you should know the minor term. Well, another term that we want to familiarize you with as we're getting to know the anatomy of these categorical syllogisms is the middle term. Middle term is the term that is repeated in both of the premises. In our example, it is the term patriots. So you see patriots appears twice. Whichever term appears twice in the premises is automatically the middle term. That's how you know what it is. In our example here, it is the word patriots. So as far as the definition, the term repeated in the premises is called the middle term. Major term, minor term, and middle term. I guess now it'd be good for a quiz, right? Let's go ahead and push on to the sample problem here. In the sample problem, it comes up on the next slide. It reads as follows. No trapeze artists are bunglers. All trapeze artists are daredevils. Thus, some daredevils are not bunglers. The trapeze artist term in this categorical syllogism is what? Major term? Well, we said major term always appears at the predicate of the conclusion. In this case, it's bunglers. That's not it. Minor term? No. If you were to say middle term, because trapeze artist appears twice in both premises, you would get the point. Middle term is the answer in this sample problem. Now that we know what the major term, the minor term, and the middle term are, let's go ahead and use this information to define major and minor premises. So in our next example, we're going to define these for you. The major premise is the premise that contains the major term. The minor premise is the premise that contains the minor term. So we know that the major term is located at the conclusion. It's also going to be in one of the premises. The minor term is the term that appears in the minor premise. So whatever the subject of the conclusion is the minor term. That term, whichever premise it appears in, is the minor premise. See how that works? You can always go back into the book, folks, if you need some examples. Well, let's talk for a moment about standard form. Standard form. As you're working with your categorical syllogisms, let's say that you translated something, an argument or something out of a newspaper or something in a debate, and you've got a categorical syllogism, before you can subject the categorical syllogism to the tools that will help you determine its validity, you have to make sure that your categorical syllogism is in standard form. Writing a syllogism that is in standard form requires you construct your syllogism with a very specific sequence. You must have the major premise first, and then the minor premise second, and then the conclusion last. Take a look here. The major premise must be listed first. The second will be the minor premise, and then finally the conclusion. This is what's called the standard form, and it requires a specific form as we've just listed here. So some people, as we said, talk about their conclusion first, and then they give you premises behind it. Well, you have to make sure that your conclusion appears last, and whatever its major term is has to be put into the major premise, which will come first. And then the subject of the conclusion is the minor premise. Whichever premise has that minor term along with the middle term will go second, and thirdly, the conclusion. Standard form, the definition of standard form. Placing a syllogism in standard form is the first requirement. Without standard form, there's no way to determine a syllogism's validity. I'll give a demonstration in a few moments here, some steps to place a syllogism in standard form. And before we do that, before we get to our next example of a syllogism that's not in standard form, we put it in, we're going to turn now to Jose, our third respondent for today. Jose, thank you so much for your email and sending that in. Jose says, another action that can get you fired is foul language. If someone I hired was using constant foul language, I would definitely fire them because I would not want somebody like that to represent my company. Very good, especially if you've got that as a pre-requirement for employment or actual terms of terminating somebody with cause, an infraction that you mentioned maybe in the employee handbook, definitely. So very good, very good. Let's see, Ayn is our fourth respondent. Thank you for emailing in. One thing that would get anyone fired from work would be to be disrespectful. If you were disrespectful or offensive to your boss or coworkers, you're almost guaranteed to be fired. Yeah, some people also, some workplace refer to that as insubordination. You are given a directive, a task that you're supposed to do, and if you do not do that, or you talk back about it, or you refuse to follow something that's already in your job description, yeah, definite grounds for termination. Thank you. Ruby, number five, and thank you, Ruby, for emailing in. Another reason to get fired from your job would be arriving late to your job. No boss would like it if you were irresponsible and uncommitted to your job. Exactly right, and maybe you might have missed that. Ruby, somebody in the video actually logs on. They're using an electronic timekeeper, and they log in the computer instead of punching a time clock, and he switched the time back half an hour on the computer so that his time card would read that he came in at the right time. Nonetheless, you get the participation point. Thank you for that. Okay, so our next slide shows a categorical syllogism that is not in standard form. Again, the first step is always to put the categorical syllogism that you're dealing with into standard form. So, this one reads, some paintings are masterpieces because some watercolors are masterpieces and all watercolors are paintings. Well, the first thing we need to do is identify the conclusion and write it at the bottom of the list. The word because that's right here indicates that everything that follows after it are premises. Therefore, the conclusion is this first statement right here. Some paintings are masterpieces. As we go to the next slide, we'll see that that's placed now down in the third position. So we've got our premises listed, 1, 2, and then the conclusion is 3, and now we've placed that down here. You see we've moved that into yellow, we've taken care of it. Here's our premise indicator words, which means that some watercolors are masterpieces, is one premise, and the other premise is all watercolors are paintings. Well, we have to follow step 1. Identify the conclusion and write at the bottom of the list. The word because indicates that the last two statements are the premises. Therefore, the conclusion here was in the first statement. So here is where our eyes will always go, as I said, the predicate of the conclusion, because that has the major term in it. The major term helps you find the major premise. So we're going to look for masterpieces between these two premises, and we see that it's here in this first sentence after because. Some watercolors are masterpieces. So if we go to the next slide, some painting or masterpieces will go into our next slide. And the predicate of the conclusion, like we said, is masterpieces. And maybe it's even the slide after that. Well, step 2 is to indicate the premise. We did that. Step 3, the premise that contains the major term. This is the major premise. And if we go to the next step, which is step 4, write the major premise in the first position on the list. So we did that right here. Some watercolors are masterpieces. The next step, step 5, we'll see in just a moment, is the minor term of the conclusion will help us identify the minor term or the minor premise in the minor term. So that's going to have paintings in it. It's right here. All watercolors are paintings. That is going to go here into the minor premise location. We will see that when we get to the next slide, I believe. Well, we have already identified that, which was step 6. Very good. Go to step 7. And that's actually right, the premise in the second place, which is now appears there. So the syllogism is now in standard form. We've got the major premise in the right place, the minor premise in the right place, and the conclusion in its correct place. We are now in what's called standard form. Very, very important. So looking at line 3 and finding the predicate of the conclusion, the masterpiece lets me know that up in the syllogism, the categorical proposition, some watercolor or masterpieces is the major premise. Major premise, minor premise, conclusion, standard form. Okay, what we want to look at next is what we will be doing with this information, and that is to determine what's called the mood and the figure, and that helps us determine the form. Mood, figure, and form. Let's stop and look at each of these to make sure that we fully comprehend these concepts, because these are the next steps that we need to follow in order to determine if this is a valid or an invalid categorical syllogism. So step 1 was to put the categorical syllogism into standard form. The next is to determine the mood and the figure, and it's the mood and the figure that help us determine whether the syllogism is valid or invalid. So here we are, step 1. Check to see if the syllogism is in standard form. And let's go back up here to our example that we're going to look at for mood and figure. No painters are sculptors. Some sculptors are artists. And the conclusion is some artists are not painters. Our eyes will gravitate immediately to the predicate of the conclusion because that's the major term, and it should be in the major premise, which is up here And yes, there it is. This tells us that the major term and the major premise are in the right place. Let's go to this next premise, which has sculptors or artists. Here is the minor term, and it does contain the minor premise. So it seems to be fine. It looks like since the conclusion is last, the premise of the conclusion, or the predicate of the conclusion, the major term, is in the first premise, and the subject of the conclusion, the minor term, is in the second premise. We are in standard form. So that's step one, to be in standard form. The next step is to properly symbolize the argument. And here we've got the quantifier no, PRS, so we came up with this for the major premise. The minor premise reads some as the quantifier sculptors are artists, and that's right here properly symbolized as some SRA. And the conclusion with our conclusion indicator word is right here, some artists are not painters, and here we've properly symbolized that, keeping the quantifier and the copula intact. So this is to symbolize using letters to represent the terms, which is step two. Let's move on to step three. Step three is where you identified the mood of the syllogism. Identifying the mood of the syllogism. And we will get to that in just a moment. It looks like we've got a caller calling in. Let's go ahead and take care of our caller, and then we can get back to mood and figure. So, caller, who is it that's calling in? Shannon from Redland.
Hello.
How are you today, Shannon?
I'm good. How are you?
I'm doing really good, too. Tell us what your response is to the question of the day.
So my response to the question of the day was that one of the things that I would fire an employee for would be unprofessional behavior or communication with a client or customer. And at the place where I work, they actually have rules stating that you can't exchange personal information with customers for that reason.
Very good. Yeah, absolutely right. Makes a lot of sense, too. Yeah, being professional so that you can advance the purposes of your company and maintaining that professional attitude, and especially not disclosing any kind of personal information. Very good. Or retaining any personal information from your customers. Shannon, you get the point. Did a great job. You have a great afternoon, okay?
Thank you.
Okay, bye-bye. Fantastic. Shannon, thank you so much. Okay, we're talking about mood and figure. And as we're going to point out, and as you'll see on the screen in front of us here, the mood is simply the letters of the propositions. That's all. So this is an E proposition, no PRS, E proposition. This here with the quantifier sum is an I proposition, and the conclusion is an O proposition. So we say that the mood is an EIO. That's all that mood is. You've got three propositions in your categorical proposition. To say the mood of it is to simply identify which of the four letters of the forms, excuse me, are your premises and your conclusion. That's all that mood is. So mood in this instance is an EIO. Figure, on the other hand, is slightly more complicated. The concept of figure is a little more complicated. The figure of a categorical syllogism is determined by the location of the two occurrences of the middle term and the premises. Figure has to do with the location of the two premises in the first two propositions of your argument. There's only four possible configurations. Therefore, there's only four possible figures identified by numbers 1 through 4. And if you have your book available with you, looks like we're running into a small amount of technical difficulty. There are four forms on page 261. Page 261. And again, we're talking about the location of the middle terms, the two middle terms that are up in those major and minor premises. There's only four possible locations. And therefore, depending upon which of those four will tell you which figure it is. The figure of that location can be either figure 1, figure 2, figure 3, or figure 4. So we've got an example on the next slide. if we're able to get some slides up, I don't know how our computer is reacting to slides today, then we want to go to slide number 28, if at all possible, and take a look at these highlighted M for middle term, locations of the middle term. So if a categorical syllogism was to have a figure of one, then the middle term would be in the subject of the major premise and in the predicate of the minor. Notice if we were to put a hash line through that, it would have like a negative sloping line. A figure two, on the other hand, a categorical syllogism can have a figure of two if the middle term appears in both the predicates of the major and the minor term. It can have a figure of three if it's in the subject of both the major and the minor premise. And the only other possible variation is figure four, where in the major premise it appears in the predicate, and in the minor premise it appears in the subject. In your book, you will see something that looks like this. Here I said that there's a figure one has a negative sloping line if you were to put a hash line through it, and over here it would have a positive sloping line for figure four if you put a hash line through the two major terms. Well, your book says that this looks like a shirt collar. And so the right-hand side of the shirt is over here for figure one. If it's on the inside right-hand side, it's a figure two. If it's on the inside left side, they call it a figure three. And again, this positive sloping line, or the left-hand side of the shirt collar, is a figure four. So M, in this example, signifies all the possible occurrences of the middle term. S represents the minor term in these cases, and P represents the major term, which is the predicate of the conclusion that you see down here. So mood and then figure, and both of those combined lead us to the form of the categorical syllogism. So now that you've heard about the shirt collar effect, which is one method of determining the figure, the other is by using this slide and the locations of the middle terms, we've got the mood and EIO, and in our example that we have here, let's go on ahead and take a look back at our next slide, which is number 32, or slide 33, either one does. Okay, here's 32 with the shirt collar. So the conclusion of this EIO is that it is not P. Let's look for now the middle term. Here is one middle term. Here is another middle term. And if we were to do our hash line or solid line through it, that tells us that this positive sloping line looks just like a figure four. So we would say that the figure on this categorical proposition that we're dealing with is a mood of EIO, but it's also a figure four. Let's go to the next slide. So the next slide says the occurrence of S are similar to the figure four in the shirt collar, so the syllogism has a figure of four. Take a look over here at this. The form now of the syllogism is represented by combining the mood and the figure, so this is an EIO4. This syllogism is also referred to as an EIO4. So let's summarize what we're doing here. The form of a categorical syllogism is determined by its mood and its figure. If you want an algebraic or an arithmetic example, it'd be mood plus figure equals form. And so the one that we've been looking at is, now we've determined by its mood and figure, therefore its form, an EIO4. We want to go to the inside back cover of our text because there are two tables that are listed. One table, the top table, is the list of unconditionally valid forms. Forms, notice that? Any categorical syllogism that has that form that's listed on that first table is automatically valid. The bottom table is the list of conditionally valid forms. and it is dependent upon whether or not a term exists or not to determine its validity. Well, what we want to do then is go to the back of the book, and we'll have you focus in with our overhead projector, the valid syllogistic forms. It might take us a few moments to get that zoomed in properly. So this, here's where we're going. And we said that there is a four columns. So we said that this is an EIO4. Thank you. Folks in the control room are always on their game, always doing an excellent job. Thanks, folks. So we're over here at figure four. Notice the valid forms that have a figure one would be listed here, figure two, figure three, figure four. We said that this argument that we're dealing with is an EIO4. So if you look very closely, the first one that's listed is an AEE. The second one, which you may or may not be able to see, is an IAI. But lo and behold, the third and last one listed says EIO. Because that EIO categorical syllogism that we found is listed among the list of unconditionally valid forms, it is automatically valid. So folks, there's nothing that we've had to draw. There's nothing that we've had to particularly analyze. We simply had to pull apart the information and determine if one of those, if the syllogism is listed here. Now, imagine, let's say that it is not listed here once you've determined the mood and the figure and therefore the form. That means that it is invalid. It's not a valid argument. But if it's listed here, then it is a valid argument. Over here, you see that there's a required condition under the conditionally valid forms, and it is that M would need to exist, that is, the middle term would need to exist, or that the P, the predicate term, would have to exist, or that might be the major term in this case. So here at the back of the book, also in section 5.1 is a similar table. You'll want to familiarize yourself with these because you will be looking here to determine if the argument you're dealing with is valid or not. So let's go to a quick recap and then a sample problem. And let's see, how are we doing on time? We're doing pretty good. There is a three-step process that we need to follow. First is to put your categorical syllogism into what's called standard form. Major premise, minor premise, and conclusion. Second step, determine the mood and the figure. The mood is simply the letter name associated for each of the premises and the conclusion. And then figure is determined by where the middle term falls. And it can either be a figure one, two, three, or four. Then the form is determined by putting those mood and figure together and then looking at the back of the book in the list of unconditionally valid forms. If it's listed in there, the argument or the categorical syllogism representing that argument is valid. If it does not appear there, then it is invalid. So let's take a look at this next slide as a sample problem and go through it slowly to make sure that you can wrap your mind around it. This has to do with computers, desktops, and laptops. And it reads as follows. Some computers are not desktops, so some computers are not laptops, for no laptops are desktops. Well, we have to take a very close look here because the concern that we have is finding the conclusion first and foremost. And let's see, here's the word so, right? And that might be meaningful for us. Some computers are not laptops. Do you remember if the word so is a conclusion indicator word? Well, it is. So that would mean that among these two choices that we have, we want to make sure that the O proposition for some computers are not laptops is in the conclusion. Here is no L or D, and that doesn't have the same correspondence if we were to symbolize it. Symbolizing this would be some C are not L. And that corresponds with this right here, some C are not L. So we want to focus on this one down here. Let's take it a step further. If L is the major term, We want to make sure that that is up in the major premise. And yes, there it is. Here is the minor term. And yes, it's here in the minor premise. These two are what called what? D represents what in these two cases? The middle term, that's correct. So this is in standard form. We would say that this is the answer. Is it in standard form? And if you chose that, you would get the point. And here's the explanation for those that would like to take a closer look at that. Well, let's go to the, let's just stop here for a second, okay? Let's go back. We said that this is the answer, and we wanted to find out what the mood and the figure of that are. So what is this? This major premise, that's an E, right? What is this right here? This the minor premise, the second premise. That's an O. And what is this conclusion? It is also an O, right? An E-O-O. We said that over here are the two middle terms. Is that a figure of one, two, or three? Do you remember? Do you want to take a look at it? That's a two, right? An E-O-O-2. So if we were to go to the back of the book, and let's go to our overhead projector, and look in column number two for figure two, what do we get? We're in figure two. We said it's an E-O-O-2. There's an E-A-E. There's an A-E-E. There's an E-I-O and an A-O-O, but there is no E-O-O-2. Therefore, the argument that's being made about laptops, computers, and desktops is an invalid argument. An invalid argument. Well, folks, why don't we do this? We are at 3:40, and I think it'd be good for us to take a break, and then we'll go to our second question of the day. Why don't we take a brief 5 minutes, then we'll continue with our lecture for Chapter 5, and when we get back, we'll give you a video to take a look at. We'll see you in 5 minutes, folks.
You are watching DHTV, the broadcast programming service of California State University, Dominguez Hills.
Hello, my name is Lira Harding. I'm a junior at California State University, Dominguez Hills. The reason why I chose this university was for small classes and interactive programs.
DHTV on Tuesday nights at 9 p.m. for Jazz in the Modern Era with Chet Hanley, the only live interactive jazz program on cable television in Southern California. If you like jazz, you'll love Jazz in the Modern Era.
Hello, I'm J. Kim McNutt, Dean of the College of Extended and International Education here at Cal State Dominguez Hills. I want to personally thank you for tuning in to our high-quality educational programming. Remember, watch, listen, learn, DHTV.
It's good. I think they rose to the occasion.
Dude,
love.
Brother,
love.
That Mandarin sauce is ridiculous. The heat was fantastic. I enjoyed the flavors.
Champion is the literal.
Enrich your life. Increase your earning potential. Cal State Dominguez Hills offers a master's degree in humanities. With a focus on the cities of the world, this master's degree can be earned in as little as 5 semesters. Evening classes are available for your convenience. Why wait? Call 310-243-3636. That's 310-243-3636.
You are watching DHTV, the broadcast programming service of California State University, Dominguez Hills.
All right, and we're back. Well, we want to go to the second video. Before we do that, let's introduce it. This is for our participation points for the second half of the day. This video introduces ethicist Peter Singer. And he discusses our obligation that we have individually to rescue, for example, a drowning child. But he uses this to make the analogy that all of us are equally responsible and just as motivated to rescue the downtrodden children, the starving children, the ill and infirm children of the world. Well, do you agree with that argument or do you disagree with that argument? Is that a compelling argument or are there some limitations to his analogy? So watch the video and then call in or text in and let us know, do you agree with Singer's analogy or do you agree, disagree or agree with Singer's analogy? Watch Dr. Peter Singer. Here he is.
Many years ago, I asked people to imagine that they are walking past a shallow pond and they see a small child who's fallen into that pond and is in danger of drowning. There's no one else around. So they can see that the child is quite likely to drown unless they wade into the pond and pull out the child. And if they do that, they know that the pond is not deep or dangerous, but they're going to ruin their shoes. So there'll be some small cost to them. And I ask my students, well, do you think it would be wrong for a person in those circumstances to say, no, I don't want to spoil my shoes, so I'm not going to wade into the pond and let the child drown? And almost everybody says, of course that would be wrong. That would be a terrible thing to do. You'd be a kind of monster to consider your shoes weighing against the life of the child. Then having got people to accept that view, I asked them, is there really such a difference between that and the situation of comfortably off people, as most people in the United States say are, as against the 1 billion who are living in extreme poverty, when we know that every day some 27,000 children die from poverty-related causes, and that those deaths could be prevented if only we would share a little bit more of our wealth to provide them with basic health care or assist them in producing enough food so we could prevent many, if not all, of these deaths. At a cost to ourselves, probably the per life saved would be no greater than a pair of shoes or sending your clothes to the cleaners.
Fantastic. So cogitate on that and then text in or call in with your response and why you agree or disagree with Singer's analogy. Well, we want to do a sample problem. We'll use this from our 12 Angry Men. And what we'll do is extract some of the argument, translate it, and then put it into standard form, the categorical proposition, and then determine if it is valid or not. So what we want to look at is Lee J. Cobb's statement from 12 Angry Men, where he says of the eyewitness, the old man who claims that he saw the boy run out of his home, he said, "I'm going to kill you." He says, "He's an old man. You saw that." Half the time he was confused. How can he be positive about anything? So let's go to the video and watch 12 Angry Men, the segment that had to do with the old man, and then we can come back and translate it. You see part of the translation there already. And folks, what I want to remind you is that we're doing something very similar to what you will do on your final project, your 12 Angry Men project. But you cannot use this argument. You will find an argument, and there's arguments all over the place among the jurors, and then you will extract that information and then translate it and then determine if it's a valid argument or not by using this method that we're talking about today, mood, figure, and form. Let's watch that video and then do the work. Here it comes.
"He was an old man. Half the time he was confused. How could he be positive about anything?
We're understanding this video in terms of what he's saying about an old man and his reliability. The context that the video uses it, though, the movie uses it, is that just as the old man can't be certain about anything, the certainty that Lee J. Cobb has been expressing, the guy that's always prone to anger, there's no basis for him to be certain about anything either. So let's go back to our slide that's in front of us here, and you see what has been said in the movie or in the book, 12 Angry Men, and we're going to translate that. So all persons identical to him, who are the old man, are persons who are old. Remember the parameter? When you say he's an old man, it lacks a proper noun, and the parameter is to use the A proposition, quantifier all, and persons identical to him. That's the same way of saying he. And we have to make it plural, so that's persons who are old. Here's the second premise. Some persons who are old are persons who are confused. Notice that they are both plural, talking about two classes of things. And then finally, down here in the third, in the conclusion, all persons who are confused are persons identical to him. So the conclusion is written last. The predicate of the conclusion is in the first premise, right? The conclusion, the predicate, persons identical to him, is also persons identical to him. So we're in standard form. We are in standard form. We've just done our translation, and so this looks to be good. Let's move to the next slide so we can talk about mood and figure, and then finally form. And the next slide tells us that the mood consists of the letters, and that's slide number 44. That the mood consists of the letter names of the propositions. So this is an A, this is an I proposition, and the conclusion is an A proposition. So mood is an AIA, as I've got listed here, AIA. Mood is an AIA. Let's go to the next slide and determine its figure. And notice here, the middle term, persons who are old, represented or symbolized by the letter O. If we wanted to put a line through it, that would be a positive sloping line, or the left-hand side of our lapel, our collar, our shirt collar. So the figure is a 4. So mood and figure, so far, is an AIA 4, and that is what gives us the form. Let's look at our next slide. So the form of the syllogism is therefore an AIA-4. If we go to the back of our book and look for an AIA-4, you'll notice that it is not listed. There is not, under column 4, an AIA. There's an IAI, but that's not the same animal. It has to correspond exactly, a one-to-one correspondence. So the argument that Lee J. Cobb, the one who's always getting angry among the jurors, his argument is invalid, and we have just established that by using this list of conditionally valid forms. So you see how that works, folks? Let's get back to some of our responses here, and thank you for either calling in or typing those in. This is Bailey. Thank you again, Bailey. Bailey says, this is a difficult question to consider in regard to ethics, and I think your perspective of this question has to come from your worldview. Oh, I like that. What is the responsibility of man towards another? Unfortunately, we live in a broken and sinful world, and because I have a biblical worldview and understand our depravity or our depraved world, I do have compassion for those that are in physical need in different parts of the world. I believe that there is a human responsibility to share what we have with those in need according to the love and compassion we've received from God if we've been born in a wealthy country. However, I don't believe that people should be forced by government law to assist others in physical need. It really needs to be an individual decision to provide assistance to those in poverty. I like that. You're not wanting, Bailey, to have on the law books a Good Samaritan law where everybody is obligated to do that. Instead, you're opting that based upon the love that is shining in their own heart that they would turn and show that same kind of compassion that was shown to them to others. Very powerful, and really like that. You also bring up another point about children in the world, which brings up the issue of proximity. Bailey, I like what you're saying, because you're saying that if there's someone close to, yeah, it's our ethic of love that's going to make us do that, but it's a little bit harder to do that for people that are all the way on the other side of the globe, unless there are some people who feel a calling or a sense of responsibility to go and be a missionary, for example, and invest their lives for several or more years into those people. And some people have that. There's also people like at my church that say, if you cannot go and do the work, support the people who do that work and show that compassion, help people around the globe. So very good thinking. Love your extended explanation. And it looks like we don't have any others at the moment, so we can get back to our lecture. You know, folks, that really wraps up section 5.1. There are some homework problems that we will list and that are also already on Blackboard, but I'll put that in the announcement. And then what we want to do is turn our attention to a couple of videos now and understand what is being said in these videos, translate the argument and put it into standard form. Once we're in standard form, we want to determine the mood and the figure and then the form, and then subject it to the list of conditionally or unconditionally valid forms. The first video that we want to take a look at is the courtroom drama in A Few Good Men. This is where Tom Cruise, as the Navy lawyer, Lieutenant Caffey, is up against Jack Nicholson, who's the Commander Jessup. And it's Caffey who thinks that Jessup probably ordered the code red that accidentally caused the murder of this inept young Marine on the base. So we want to identify and then translate Tom Cruise's argument. If we had time, we would look at Jack Nicholson's argument. But let's go on ahead and look at this segment where the statement is, you can't handle the truth, from A Few Good Men. Take a look at this.
If you gave an order that Santiago wasn't to be touched, and your orders are always followed, then why would Santiago be in danger? Why would it be necessary to transfer him off the base?
Santiago was a substandard Marine. He was being transferred.
That's not what you said. You said he was being transferred because he was in grave danger.
That's correct.
You said he was in danger. I said grave danger. You said, is there any
other... I recall what I said.
I can have the court reporter read back to you.
I know what I said. I don't have to have it read back to me like I'm...
Why the two orders? Colonel?
Sometimes men take matters into their own hands.
No, sir. You made it clear just a moment ago that your men never take matters in their own hands. Your men follow orders or people die. So Santiago shouldn't have been in any danger at all, should he have, Colonel?
You snake.
Your Honor, I'd like to ask for a recess.
I'd like an answer to the question, Judge.
The court will wait for an answer.
If Lieutenant Kendrick gave an order that Santiago wasn't to be touched, then why did he have to be transferred? Colonel, Lieutenant Kendrick ordered the code red, didn't he? Because that's what you told Lieutenant Kendrick to do.
Object!
And when it went bad, you cut these guys loose!
Your Honor,
you have marches inside the bony transport!
Your Honor,
you doctored the logbook!
Damn it, Captain!
You coerced the doctor!
Consider yourself in contempt!
Colonel Jessup, did you order the code red?
You don't have to answer that question.
I'll answer the question. You want answers?
I think I'm entitled to.
You want answers?
I want the truth!
You can't handle the truth! Son, we live in a world that has walls, and those walls have to be guarded by men with guns. Who's gonna do it? You? You, Lieutenant Weinberg? I have a greater responsibility than you can possibly fathom. You weep for Santiago and you curse the Marines. You have that luxury. You have the luxury of not knowing what I know, that Santiago's death, while tragic, probably saved lives. And my existence, while grotesque and incomprehensible to you, saves lives. You don't want the truth because deep down in places you don't talk about at parties, you want me on that wall. You need me on that wall. We use words like honor, code, loyalty. We use these words as the backbone of a life spent defending something. You use them as a punchline. I have neither the time nor the inclination to explain myself to a man who rises and sleeps under the blanket of the very freedom that I provide and then questions the manner in which I provide it. I would rather you just said thank you and went on your way. Otherwise, I suggest you pick up a weapon and stand a post. Either way, I don't give a damn what you think you are entitled to.
Did you order the code red?
I did the job.
Did you order the code red?
You're goddamn right I did!
Okay. High drama indeed, right? Well, we want to analyze what was being said here. And if we turn our attention to the electronic slate, we want to analyze in terms of the validity of what's being said here. So Colonel Jessup says, you want answers, right? And then Lieutenant Caffey says, I think I'm entitled. Jessup responds back, you want answers. Caffey says, I want the truth. Jessup responds, well, you can't handle the truth, right? Well, let's go on ahead and translate this here. We have to be a little creative. And it looks like Caffey is saying, from his standpoint, all lawyers are people who want answers. Okay, he wants an answer, but if we were to say Caffey wants an answer, and well, he's a lawyer, we have to use the proper quantifier and a subject term. So it's lawyers are people who want answers. Same thing here with the minor premise. We'll check and see if that's a proper form or not, standard form. All people who want truth are lawyers. And then finally, all people who want the truth are people who want answers. So this is a rough translation, basically putting in categorical syllogistic form what is being said. We first have to identify the major term. What is the major term? Well, we go to the conclusion. Here's our copula. The conclusion of the predicate of the conclusion, it's going to be people who want answers, right? People who want answers. And the minor term, that's people who want the truth, who want the truth. Now, if we symbolize this, these would just be letters down here. What's the middle term? What is the middle term? Well, first it's defined as the term that appears in both premises. How about this lawyers? Lawyers, right? So the middle term is going to be lawyers. What's the mood? Remember, the mood is simply the middle name, or the letter of each of these propositions. What is the major premise, right? What about this minor premise? And the conclusion, it's also a letter A. So if we were to put down the mood, it's going to be an AAA. What's the figure? Well, we've got it up here in the middle term is up here in the subject and over here in the predicate. So isn't that going to be a figure of a one? Yes. So the form is the combination of mood and figure in AAA 1. And we go to the list at the back of our book or on the appropriate page. And we went to the overhead cam and took a look and to see if in figure 1 if there's an AAA. And that's the very first entry. An AAA 1 is a valid argument because it's listed there. We would say then going back to our tablet here that this is a valid argument. V-A-L-I-D. This is a valid argument. We just established that by making sure we were in standard form and getting the mood and the figure and establishing the form and then looking it up on the list of valid forms. Why don't we do this? Let's go to the next video. And this is the name of the rose with Sean Connery, 007 in the lead role. And it takes place in the medieval ages and in the abbey and attending a library there are these murders. And the strange thing about these murders is everyone that's murdered has a blackened tongue. So this is a remake of Umberto Eco's The Name of the Rose. Highly developed logic is what William of Baskerville or Sean Connery shows. Let's take a look at The Name of the Rose. This is the trailer, and then we will take a look at the argument that's embedded in there. Watch this.
Within these walls, men come to seek God. He has come to seek a killer.
We found the body horribly mutilated under a window which was
found closed.
Somebody told you.
A man of reason in a world of blind faith.
Yes, small blood here.
You mean that he committed suicide?
Elementary.
And a crime that could not be suppressed.
Ink stains.
He did not write with his tongue, I presume.
I don't like this place.
I find it most stimulating.
Should we tell him?
No. I am most curious to see the library for myself. May I do so?
No.
But what if you should learn it of his own accord?
Written with lemon juice.
Hey! Who's there?
You overestimate his talents.
This one, I grant you, did not commit suicide. When he is challenged by a man of cruelty and power, the hunter becomes the hunted.
Brethren, if you please!
The matter has occurred of the utmost gravity.
Had someone else not chosen to look in the wrong direction, several men of God might still be with us.
Our monks will meet their deaths here, and they also will have blackened fingers and blackened tongues.
His hand is black, just as Brother William foretold.
Yes, I was right.
He knew. Just as I, too, would have known had I been the murderer.
You go that way. Lock them up!
One final murder has been planned.
Master! Master! How do we get out?
With some difficulty.
And it's his. Sean Connery. F. Murray Abraham. The Name of the Rose. A story of honor.
We'll get back to unpacking The Name of the Rose in just a few minutes. We've got somebody that's just calling in and several people that have also responded with emails. Why don't we turn to our telephone first, and then we can find out what the respondent has to say. And who is this that's calling? Cher from Stockton?
Yeah. Yeah.
How you doing?
I'm good. How are you?
I'm doing really good, too. Thanks. What's your response today?
I would say that I agree with Singer's analogy, okay, that it is our responsibility to help a child in poverty, uh-huh, as it is to help a child that's drowning.
Uh-huh.
Since in both cases, the fate of the child lies in the observer's hand.
Uh-huh.
I agree with what Bailey mentioned about how each individual should make their own decision, but I also think that people should help someone in such dire need.
Yeah. And Cher, I think that's a great response. You know, I tend to believe too. Tell me, if you're going to be sending money to maybe some relief organization that's operating at some other part of the world that you might have some compassion for, is there any due diligence that you would do to make sure that your funds are getting to the right place? Or what would you do to make sure that the support you're wanting to give is actually taking place? Or can you find out with some confidence that what you're planning to do to bring relief to somebody is actually taking place? What crosses your mind when a question like that is put to you?
Well, that's a really good question, because you never know if these middle management companies are taking some of that, some of those funds for their own, gain.
Right, right. Yeah, that's one of my primary concerns when I look at a lot of relief organizations. And like you, I question if maybe there's a higher percentage that some organizations take off the top of their donations, whereas some operate very frugally. And I don't know a lot of times how to find that out. Maybe I need to do some investigative work. But I agree with what you're saying. Cher, any final thoughts?
While we're on that note, I remember going to Raley's one time, and they had a drop-off for coins, and they said for every dollar you give, a cent is given to those who transferred the funds.
Nice. Very nice. Wasn't there a saying a while back, think globally, but act locally? And so I keep a few extra bucks in my car console so that if I run across somebody in the street that's panhandling, I'll usually hand them a couple of dollars. Or if I know that there's a particular person out on the avenue at a particular time and I'm going through a drive-thru to get some fast food, I'll get an extra hamburger and hand it off. I think we all have a responsibility. Singer's argument, I think, has some compelling weight to it. It's also got some limitations, but I'm so pleased to hear that a number of you are sharing similar sentiments about bearing a responsibility for these that are less fortunate. Maybe your generation will finally change the tide, right?
Hopefully.
Cher, thanks so much for calling in. Appreciate all your thoughts and the way you respond verbally, too. You're very articulate. Thank you.
Thank you.
All right. Bye-bye. Let's turn our attention to Asher and what he's texted in. Asher says, I do not think that there is a difference. Sharing our wealth with the unwealthy is not different from ruining our shoes to save a child. It should be a choice, though. Should not be a law to help. Very good. I like that. Thank you, Asher. Jose says, I disagree with Singer's analogy because when he talks about saving a child from drowning, it's an instant reaction to help out. It would be seen as wrong not to, because not only is it a child, but it is also drowning. Helping out others in poverty is different because you don't see every single person in poverty. And to be consistent with what you're saying, Jose, not all of them are dying. And I think you've got something there. The less you see, the less you're going to feel about going to feel necessary to help out. A large amount of work like helping out those in poverty cannot be compared to a small job like helping a kid from drowning, because the effort required to do is too large for some people. You know, these are some great thoughts that you've got, Jose. A very good reasoning process also. Appreciate your analysis. It's very insightful. Thank you. Jordan, thank you so much for your response today. Although I do think that we should help those in need, I feel that Singer's analogy is a bit weak. There's a difference between being the only person there to help someone and being one of millions who have the ability to help. Very thoughtful, Jordan. Yeah. There seems to be a different sense of urgency and pressure. Yeah, very good. I like that. Jordan, that too is very insightful, very good reasoning process behind your thoughts as well. Thank you for that. You young scholars really are young scholars. Okay, what we are looking at is The Name of the Rose. That's the video that we just saw. The reason for the blackened tongues is there was in the library a forbidden book. And there were some translations that these copyists were doing in the scriptorium, and they would come across from the ancient text some books that they labeled as forbidden. And the abbot or somebody poisoned the page so that when somebody got a hold of it and wanted to read it, they would die. The poisoning of the page then took advantage of the habit that readers had in those days, and that is to lick their finger so they could turn the piece of parchment or the vellum, you know, the thick page. And there's just a habit that they got into, and they would ingest the poison that way. So that's how it happened. Well, let's take a look here at our screen. And the point we want to take a look at is where Sean Connery says, other monks will meet their deaths here, and they also will have blackened fingers and blackened tongues. Well, let's start here with the all monks who have been murdered are monks with black tongues and fingers. So far, every single monk, all monks who were murdered, had black tongues and fingers. There was one later that was not, but at that point, that is the case. The second assertion, or the second premise, reads, some monks who will meet their deaths here are monks who have been murdered. There was one that had, or there are some that would have natural occurrences. You know, through the course of the time, there not all of them would be murdered. Some, just due to age, would be dying. So the most we could say is some, not all. Lastly, in the conclusion, some monks who will meet their deaths here are monks with black tongues and fingers. Not all of them will have black tongues and fingers, but some. So let's go on ahead and identify what our major term is. The major term is always the conclusion, the conclusion predicate, and that's going to be monks with black tongues and fingers. This is the major term. The minor term is going to be here in the subject of the conclusion. Monks who will meet their deaths. This here, all of this, or if we wanted to symbolize it, would be the minor term. How about this middle term here? Middle term, as you recall, is the term that's repeated twice in both premises. Monks who have been murdered and monks who have been murdered. So the middle term is going to be monks who have been murdered. What's the mood on this? Did anybody have that? Can you see that? This is an A, right? What's this? Some monks are. Is that an O? No, an O has R not, so that's an I. Some monks who will meet their deaths are monks of black. That's also an I. So the mood is an A, I, I. How about the figure? That's the location of monks who have been murdered. Here it's in the subject. Here it's in the predicate, which is a negative sloping line or a figure of one. I'm sorry, this one goes here, and here's the A, I, I, one. We go to the back of the book. Let's look at column one. And I think I left the book in the same place for the overhead cam. Let's see. Oh, maybe not. There we are. AAA, EAE, AII, the third entry in figure one, corresponds to the argument that we've just analyzed. So that means that this is a valid argument. The argument that we're looking at is a valid argument. So we go back after we've looked at our list of valid forms, and we would say that this too is valid. Folks, I think we want to look at next the Silence of the Lambs. Very popular movie. Yeah, there we go. This is the 1991 crime drama and horror film starring Jodie Foster and, Anthony Hopkins as Hannibal Lecter. And he differentiates himself from other killers in that he retains a trophy. He keeps a trophy. And so let's watch the exchange of Silence of the Lambs, and then we'll see about what we can detect in terms of any argument and its validity. Watch the Silence of the Lamb. You ate yours. Here we are.
Did you do all these rocks, Doctor?
That is the Duomo scene from the Belvedere.
You know Florence?
All that detail just from memory, sir?
Memory, Agent Starling, is what I have instead of a view.
Well, perhaps you'd care to lend us your view on this questionnaire, sir.
No. You were doing fine. You had been courteous and receptive to courtesy. You had established trust with the embarrassing truth about Miggs. And now this ham-handed segue into your questionnaire. It won't do.
I'm only asking you to look at this, Doctor. Either you will or you won't.
Yeah. Jack Crawford must be very busy indeed if he is recruiting help from the student body. Busy hunting that new one, Buffalo Bill. What a naughty boy he is. Do you know why he's called Buffalo Bill? Please tell me. The newspapers won't say.
Well, it started as a bad joke in Kansas City homicide. They said, this one likes to skin his humps.
Why do you think he removes their skins, Agent Starling? Throw me with your acumen.
It excites him. Most serial killers keep some sort of trophies from their victims.
I didn't.
No. No, you ate yours.
Okay, let's go to our electronic slate. And it says here, most serial killers keep some sort of trophy. I didn't. No, you ate yours. So some trophy killers are serial killers. Quantifier copula. No trophy keepers are people like Dr. Lecter who eat their trophies. Conclusion, some people like Dr. Lecter who eat their trophies are serial killers. Why don't we go ahead and symbolize this? And we'll call this first one here, some TRS. First premise, or the major premise. The minor premise is the second one, and that's going to be no T, right? No trophy keepers are people like Dr. Lecter. We'll just go in and put P. And then, of course, our conclusion, some P, R, S, serial killers. So our eyes immediately go down to the conclusions predicate. That's always the major term, S. And of course, if we go back to it, that would be serial killers. The minor term is over here in the subject of the conclusion, and it's P in this case. And P is people like Dr. Lecter. And the middle term, look at that. It's these two right here where T appears, and we'll just call it T, which is trophy keepers. What did you get for the mood? Take a close look. Tell me what you have for mood there. Right, this is an I, this is an E, and this is an I proposition. So the mood is an IEI. Take a look at figure, see if you can get that. One is going this way, two is going this way over here at the right. Three is if they're in this configuration, so this is a figure three. The form of this argument is an IEI3, and from there we go to the back of the book. Look in column three and see if it's there. Column three, is there an IEI? No, there isn't. It's not there. There's an AII, but there's no IEI. So this is an invalid argument. And we write the word invalid next to the problem, and we get the point, saying that it's an invalid argument. I think the next one that we want to take a look at is, The Godfather? Yes, it is. I was going to do a Bugs Bunny, but we don't have time for that. This is young Corleone, who is Al Pacino, is not wanting to get involved with the family business all along until the point where somebody takes a couple shots at his father, Marlon Brando. Now, to retaliate, his brother says, but we thought you weren't going to get mixed up in the family business. He says, well, it's strictly business. It's not personal. And so you'll see the line in Francis Ford Coppola's 1972 masterpiece, The Godfather. Let's see if we're ready, and we'll go ahead and run our video. Here it is, The Godfather.
What about this, McCluskey? Huh? What do we do with this copy?
They want to have a meeting with me, right? It will be me, McCluskey, and Saletsa. Let's set the meeting. Get our informers to find out where it's going to be held. Now, we insist it's a public place, a bar, a restaurant, someplace where there's people so I feel safe. They're going to search me when I first meet them, right? So I can't have a weapon on me then. But if Clemenza can figure a way to have a weapon planted there for me, then I'll kill them both.
Hey, what are you gonna do? Nice college boy, huh? Didn't want to get mixed up in the family business? Now you want to gun down a police captain, why? Because he slapped you in the face a little bit? Huh? What do you think, this is the army where you shoot him a mile away? You gotta get up close like this, and bada-bing, you blow their brains all over your nice Ivy League suit. Come here. Mwah! You're taking this very personal. Tom, this is business, and this man is taking it very, very personal.
Where does it say that you can't kill a cop?
Come on, Mikey.
Tom, wait a minute. I'm talking about a cop that's mixed up in drugs. I'm talking about a dishonest cop, a crooked cop who got mixed up in the rackets and got what was coming. That's a terrific story. And we have newspaper people on the payroll, don't we, Tom? And they might like a story like that.
They might. They just might. It's not personal, Sonny. It's strictly business.
Al Pacino, one of the greats. Okay, let's turn our attention to our electronic slate and let's see if we can unpack some of this. First line is, some people who should be killed are dishonest, drug-involved cops in the rackets. Now, here's our copula. We got two classes of things, so we're doing good. All dishonest, drug-involved cops in the rackets are people who get what's coming to them. And finally, some people who get what's coming to them are people who should be killed. Well, folks, what I'd like you to do is take advantage of this and go ahead and symbolize it, and then come up with your answers, your own answers, and fill out what is the major term, what's the minor term, the middle term, the mood, the figure, the form, and then determine if it is a valid argument or an invalid argument, and then might have you share some of your findings as participation points, or at least just call in, at least let me know what you got, and we'll complete it. I'll complete it also next time we convene. Our time is up. Folks, we will see you again next Wednesday. Young scholars, have a great middle of the week, and we'll see you in Chapter 5 next week. Take care.